So we have, if we use the set of densities as they are, without square roots, the L2 distance between two densities is a direct, what I call the direct L2 distance. And for these two be possible, you need the densities to be squared integrable, okay, which they are not normally guaranteed to be. On the other hand, if you work with the square root of densities, the distance is different, is the L2 norm of the difference of the square root, which is the familiar Hellinger distance, which reduces to the Fisher-Rao information metric if you work in the finite dimensional family. For this to be computed, you only need the densities to be L1, which is clearly a more a relaxed condition. Okay, now, if you call phi the inverse of the chart, depending on which chart you take, whether with the square root or not, the scores, the partial derivatives with respect to the coordinates form the so-called tangent space to the finite dimensional manifold of densities you have chosen. These vectors are linearly independent L2 vectors that span indeed the so-called tangent space of the family. And when you take the inner product of any two vectors, tangent vectors, if you choose the densities without square root, you get the inner product, the integral of the product of the partial derivatives, which is a metric I call gamma. If you choose the square roots and you do the calculation of the L2 inner product of these two vectors, you get the familiar Fisher information matrix. Okay, so the Fisher information matrix, as you all know, is induced by the Hellinger distance on the final from the L2 structure on the square roots of densities on the finite dimensional manifold. You can also compute immediately, because you have an inner product, you have a metric, you can compute immediately a projection. So you can project from the total L2 space, infinite dimensional L2 space, into the finite dimensional family you've chosen using this orthogonal projection formula, the standard orthogonal projection formula, and you can do it either with the L2 direct metric, or putting the square roots here, you can do it also, and the Fisher information matrix here, you can do it also with the you know, Fisher-Rao, Hellinger distance. Okay. Now, the filtering problem is, as I said, a kind of inverse problem that was very popular up to the 90s when the Cold War ended. You know, it was used a lot in the military applications, but also in water level prediction, economic systems estimation, navigation of spacecrafts. The Apollo missions used a lot of filtering algorithms themselves. So it's a field that is in signal processing still has a huge domain of applications. The most famous filter is the filter for the linear case, the Kalman filter. In that case, the optimal filter is a Gaussian distribution, so it's finite dimensional. You can parameterize it with mean and variance covariance matrix. In general, however, this is not so. So in a diffusion setting, you have a stochastic differential equation X for a signal, which has a noise term W, which is a Brownian motion, which is a mathematical model for white noise, if you're thinking in engineering terms. And you have a second stochastic process, Y, here, which you observe. So you don't observe X, you don't see this process here, you see this process here, which is a transformation of X to a function B, plus another noise process V, which is another Brownian motion, okay? And the problem is, find the best possible estimation of X from the observation of the process Y. So it's in a way, you know what I was saying, a Bayesian inference problem, but also a sort of inverse problem. Now, the stochastic calculus we use typically for the system is the Itô calculus, because it has better probabilistic properties. However, to deal with differential geometry, you need the chain rule to work if you want to have stochastic differential equations which are covariant with respect to the change of coordinates. That's why we use the other stochastic calculus, the Stratonovich stochastic calculus, for deriving the filter. The filtering problem solution is the whole probability distribution of the state given the observations up to time t. Okay, this is formally a filtration generated by the observation process to know the whole statistics of the signal, which you cannot see given the observation, means that you know the whole probability distribution, okay? The problem is, usually this may have a density, which we call P, T, but this density does not live in any finite dimensional family. It has been proved for even toy models that this equation, which takes the equation for P, which takes the form of a stochastic PDE on top, we've written here with the Stratonovich stochastic calculus, which is the circle you see at the end. This stochastic PDE does not live in any finite dimensional family, Gaussian mixtures, exponentials, nothing. If you try even a toy model where you have basically the dynamics in the state and just standard deviation one diffusion coefficient, and you observe the cube of the signal, this is a very simple system. Even this system does not give you a finite dimensional manifold. So in a way, we have a problem of dramatic course of dimensionality because our equation is infinite dimensional. And we want to approximate in a good way with the finite dimensional system because we want to implement it in a computer. And to do that, we need finite dimensional approximation. Now, what we can do, we can project that stochastic partial differential equation with the geometric structure on the family of densities I described earlier and obtain a finite dimensional stochastic differential equation that approximates the PDE, the stochastic PDE. This can be done directly with the direct L2 matrix or with the Ellinger-Fischer-Rau matrix if you use the square roots. You have two possibilities here. Okay? Well, you have more than two actually, but I'm focusing on these two. Now, the reason why we use Stratonovich calculus is that we need the chain rule. Once you have, on the left-hand side, you compute the differential of the parametric density. This is a curve in the parameter space. You can use the chain rule. These are tangent vectors, and this is going to be the equation for your parameters. If you don't have Stratonovich calculus, but you use Itô calculus, the other stochastic calculus, which is nicer probabilistically, but has this problem that this differential is going to involve second order terms that you don't know really how to interpret. Well, we are investigating that right now. It has to do with jets. But at the moment, you know, in the previous framework, we don't know how to interpret it in geometric terms. So we use Stratonovich calculus, and if you want to look at the projected equation quickly, this is how it looks like. It's an equation for the parameter now, and it's a finite dimensional equation. It's not infinite dimensional anymore. The integrals you see come from the L2 projection structure. So unfortunately, I only have 25 minutes, so I don't have time to describe you the structure of these equations. But what I would like you to appreciate is that depending on the metric you pick, the equation is different. So this one is the optimal projection in the sense of the vector fields in the stochastic PDE for the metric L2, the direct metric where you use the densities. If you use the square root of densities and the Ellinger distance, you have the second equation, and they are different in this key term, which is the prediction term. It's this term that throws you out of the tangent space of whichever family you choose in the original PDE, stochastic PDE. So that is the operator, the diffusion operator, the second order parabolic operator, operator is what gives you the infinite dimensionality here. It corresponds to the prediction step in the filtering algorithm. So this is integrated in a different way in the two projections depending on the metric you choose, and clearly the matrix here for the metric is also different. So you have in a way that the projected equation clearly depends on the manifold you choose, the parametrization P of theta, but it also depends clearly on the metric you choose, which is induced by the L2 structure. Okay, so one first choice that you can do, which is related to some work we did in the 90s, is the exponential families. So we know from the work of Giovanni Pistone, Amari, Bardolph-Nielsen, and many, many others, that exponential families have good geometric properties in connection with the Fischer metric and the Ellinger distance. So we pick as a parametric family an exponential family where the exponent functions C are multiplied by the parameter in an affine way, and this is the normalizing constant to ensure that they integrate to one. Now, the tangent space, even if you work with square roots and you use the Ellinger distance, because of the exponential structure, the square roots don't ruin your life, okay? It's still manageable, even with square roots. The Fisher matrix is simple and is simply the second derivative of the normalizing constant with respect to the parameters. This is all well known. You can design, you can calculate the projection explicitly, and that's relatively simple. If you do the calculation with an exponential family in Fisher matrix, it's very nice. And also, if you put the function in the observation process y, the function b, among the exponent of the family, then the projection of the correction term of the filter becomes exact. So in a way, if we go back to the stochastic PDE, the projection of the last term on the right-hand side, the term in the observation process, which corresponds to the correction term in the filtering when you get new information, that projection is exact. There is no approximation. The only approximation is in the prediction part, in the parabolic operator, which is important to know because you can make the correction step perfect. You can choose a manifold that makes the correction step perfect. So it's really, once again, what gives you the infinite dimensionality is the prediction step, the parabolic operator of the diffusion. Okay, you can define a local and global filtering error through the overarching L2 distance, which I'll show you an example shortly. You have an alternate bi-orthogonal parametrization, which is the moments with the exponential family. So if you take the expected value with respect to the parameter theta of the exponent functions themselves, this defines a vector of parameter eta, which is another set of coordinates in the manifold. And it turns out to be very useful when you do moment matching, assume density filters and other parametrization. And indeed, one of the classical results we derived in the 90s is that the geometric projection in Fisher metric for an exponential family coincides with the local moment matching algorithm that you use to close the moment equations of the filter and make them finite dimensional by force. This heuristic method, which is simply brute force method, corresponds to a geometric projection. So it has a more rigorous counterpart, which is equivalent to it. But one point I want to make in this talk quickly is that the exponential families do not couple well with the direct L2 metric. They work well with the Ellinger when you take the square root, but they don't work as well with the direct metric gamma. If you try to compute it, it behaves more awkwardly. The absence of the square root makes the calculations more complicated. So, is there another parametric family, not the exponential, that we can use with the direct metric rather than the Fisher-Rao metric and makes the filter convenient? The answer is affirmative, and it's the mixture family. So let's look at the simple case, the simplest possible case of a mixture of distribution. You take n plus 1 component densities, you parameterize the simplex with this vector of n plus 1 real numbers between 0 and 1 that add up to 1, and then you define the finite dimensional manifold as the linear convex combination of the densities according to the parameters theta. Okay, so this is the simplex, it's very simple, it's a convex combination of given densities. The parameters in this manifold are the combinators. Okay, so now what we want to do, we want to see, you know, how the metric looks like and then tangent space. The tangent space is very simple, does not depend on the parameters at all. It's the same everywhere. And the metric does not depend on the space, on the point of the space where you are either. It's computed through this integral offline. If you were using the Ellinger distance instead of the direct distance, this would not be true. And then you can see that the tangent space is this very, as I said, this very simple form. And the L2 projection also is very simple because the tangent space is that simple. So you can show, actually, that with this structure I just described, the projection filter is equivalent to a Galerkin method, which is not very surprising. You know, Galerkin method, you take an infinite L2 series and you truncate it arbitrarily. This is the rigorous projection with this metric and this structure is equivalent to truncating the L2 series. So it's a nice interpretation that, again, can make the Galerkin method more rigorous geometrically. So to summarize in a table, according to the family of distributions and the metric that you choose to simplify this infinite dimensional problem, you can have a good combination. If you use the Ellinger Fischer-Rau metric, you work well with exponential family. You get that they are equivalent to assume a density filter, like a local moment matching. If you choose the mixture families, they work well with the direct metric, not with the Fischer metric, and they are equivalent to a Galerkin method. Okay, so you should ideally pick the diagonal of this table, not the other diagonal. Okay, then there is a problem with this picture. If you take a convex combination of densities, the mean of the general combination will be between the lowest mean and the highest mean in the components. So for a real filtering problem, this can be a severe limitation, which means then we can take a mixture where also the mean and the variance of the single components are parameters. So if you take a mixture of two Gaussians, you have five coordinates. The mixing parameter of the convex combination, theta, and then you have the mean and variance of the first normal and the mean and the variance of the second Gaussian. So five parameters for these two mixture of two distributions. And now I'm going to show you how this works in the last 2 minutes on a problem. This was presented already by John Armstrong 2 years ago, but I would like to show you this example again in the light of what I just said in terms of equivalence. So we have a signal that is simply white noise with a given amplitude sigma, and we observe its square plus another noise, okay? Now you observe the square of something that is essentially a Gaussian noise signal. So you don't know whether it's positive or negative because you only observe the square. So if you observe +4, it could be +2, but it could be -2. So you expect a bimodal distribution, right? So let's have a look quickly at how the different filters work. I have a mixture of two densities, Gaussian densities. I use an exponential family of fourth order polynomials in the exponent, which will be the pink graph, an extended Kalman filter, which is based on linearizing the nonlinear equations so that you get a Gaussian density, as in the linear filter. But it's a heuristic approximation. And then we also have an exact filter based on a finite difference method with 1,000 state and 5,000 time steps. So the initial density is of the optimal filter is a slightly uncertain state. We start from a random initial condition, so it's the green bimodal densities. The best approximation at time zero of the red filter is the same, basically, is the Gaussian mixture captures this very well. The exponential in pink also captures the bimodal behavior okay. Of course, the extended Kalman filter, assuming a Gaussian density, can only do this. But this becomes interesting as we move on and the uncertainty increases. If you observe the evolution, you get this kind of situation, you see. Now, this is very interesting. After 3 seconds, the filter, the optimal filter is bimodal. It has some probability weights on -2 and some probability weight in +2. The mixture in red captures this very well. The exponential filter still captures it relatively well, but the Gaussian filter, the extended Kalman filter, clearly takes only one of the two modes. So it doesn't see this at all, okay? So where there is a rich geometric structure in the optimal filter, you're better off designing a manifold that captures this structure in terms of qualitative properties. You go on and you get a similar back and forth with the conditional density, and after 8 seconds, you get this very marked, bimodal character in the optimal filter, which is captured quite well by the mixture. It's captured relatively well by the exponential as well, but not by the extended Kalman filter. Okay, I would then conclude by showing you the projection residual. This is the L2 norm difference between the optimal filter and the approximation. In red is the mixture, in blue is the exponential, and in green is the Gaussian extended Kalman filter. As you see, the exponential and the mixture do better, they stay low, which means that the arrival of new information in a Bayesian way is able to bring the approximate filter towards the optimal one, even if we're comparing a five-dimensional approximation to an infinite-dimensional one. Still, we have a quite limited error in terms of L2 norm. But clearly, because it only tracks one of the modes of the bimodal distribution, the Gaussian filter doesn't have a small error. It keeps increasing in a way. Yeah, I'm almost done. So, we also did a comparison with the particle methods, because now particle filters are very popular. So we designed the linear combination of three Dirac masses located in 3 points with 2 combinators and the third one given by the convex combination. And the best you can do, we use the Levy metric here, the Levy-Prokhorov metric, because the Ellinger distance doesn't work very well with singular, and the direct L2 even worse with singular densities. And we still see that the projection filter with the exponential family and the mixture families do much better than the best particle filter with the same number of parameters, okay? That's an important qualification. Of course, if you increase the particles to a very large number, you can beat even these two filters, but the point is you want to have an algorithm that works quickly. If you use a lot of particles, your algorithm will not be in real time. I'll skip this and conclude. So I presented an approximate finite dimensional filtering algorithm that is based on the rigorous projection and geometric structure on the space of densities. The projection uses the overarching L2 structure. You can use two different metrics, the direct L2 metric or the Ellinger Fisher metric if you insert the square root. The Fisher works well with the exponential family. You have multimodality, as we have seen in the example. The correction step can be made exact. It's simple for implementation, and it's equivalent with the local moment matching. These are all nice properties. If you use the direct L2 matrix, this works better with mixture families. You have even simpler filtering equation. The basic version is equivalent to Galerkin methods, which are well known and for which a lot of numerical techniques are available. It works also very well for multimodal problems. We have just seen an example now. And it can be competitive with particle methods when it has the same number of parameters. Now, we're investigating now more a notion of optimality, in which sense the projection is optimal, and according to which criterion, besides clearly the metric on the manifold. Do we have a notion of optimality that goes more towards mainstream statistics and stochastic analysis? We do, but there's no time to talk about that now. It's forthcoming joint work with John Armstrong, so maybe GSI 17 or the next one. Thank you very much.
Talking about choosing a special functions in such a way that
yes, the correction. Yes.
Do you think that there is some link between this point and conjugate priors?
Oh, good question. There could be. This property comes from the fact that if you write the observations in discrete time rather than continuous, then the correction step is simply the Bayes formula. And if you take the family that includes the observation function in the exponent, you just need to update the parameter to do the integral. So it could be related to that, yes. It's a good point. Yeah.
This is interesting. Is there any condition for particular conditions?
No, it's just general integrability conditions. And then, you know, the difference is that the projection filter only requires you to choose the M components. So in a way, you could prolong the L2 series in any way that is reasonable, and you will still find the same, you know, kind of Galerkin method. So I think, we have a detailed statement and proof in the full paper, so there's not much time to talk about that now, but there's no specific condition that I can think of, very strong condition, no. Yeah, it's relatively general.
No question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.